Jodie Loomis was free-spirited and passionate, quick to speak her mind, and, like many young adults in the early 1970s, was somewhat of a hippie. She was a talented artist and had painted her bedroom walls with a mural of running horses. She rescued and cared for injured animals. She loved horseback riding and her horse, Soddy, and was devoted to taking care of him. In 1972, 20-year-old Jodie was living in a house on Winesap Road between Mill Creek and Bothell, Washington, with her parents, John and Rose Mary, her 12-year-old sister Jana, and her fiancé, Jim Roberts. On the afternoon of August 23rd, she left home to go to the stable where her horse was boarded, 6 miles away. One of her parents would normally drive her to the stable, but today she decided to ride her white 10-speed bike there. Before Jodie left home, her mother reminded her to take a dime with her so that she could call home from a payphone if she would be late returning. While Jodie was an adult, Rosemary was obviously still concerned with her daughter's safety and preferred for her to return home before dark. Jodie took the dime with her, but never called home, and did not arrive home as expected either. Rosemary began to worry, and that worry had turned to panic by 11 p.m. when there was a knock on her door. It was a detective who was there to notify the family that Jodie had been sexually assaulted and murdered. Rosemary collapsed at the news, and John Loomis was too shocked to catch his wife before she fell to the floor. Jodie had never arrived at her intended destination. After leaving home, she went to ask her friend and neighbor, Linda Hook, if she wanted to go riding with her. But Linda could not go because she was in the process of packing for an upcoming move to California. The last known person to see Jodie before she was attacked was a 14-year-old girl selling apples at a fruit stand at the end of her family's driveway near Bothell Everett Highway and 164th Street Southeast, approximately halfway between Jodie's home and the stable. The girl remembered seeing Jodie because she was riding her bike while wearing boots and had stopped for an unusually long amount of time before passing through the intersection at Bothell Everett Highway in onto what was at the time called Penny Creek Road and is today known as Mill Creek Road. Jodie would later be found on a dirt road off of Penny Creek Road. Around 5:30 p.m., 18-year-old Kathy Gogol and 33-year-old Walter Morris were driving through that wooded area trying to find somewhere to go target shooting when they came across a fallen tree that blocked their way. When Walter got out of the car, he discovered a young woman lying near the tree. She was mostly nude and had a serious head injury, which would later be determined to be from a gunshot wound. She was unable to talk, but was still breathing. Walter was driving a small two-seater Saab Sonnet and did not think he and Kathy could fit the woman in the car with them, so he initially suggested that Kathy stay with the woman while he went for help. However, Kathy, concerned both that whoever had harmed the young woman was still in the area, and that the young woman's injuries were too severe to wait for him to leave and come back, insisted that they take the young woman to the hospital right then. They were somehow able to fit the young woman in the car with them. They did not take the time to try to redress the young woman, given the serious nature of her injuries and their desire to get her to the hospital quickly. So Kathy did her best to cover up the young woman in the car so that other drivers on the road could not see her in her state of undress through the car window. Kathy and Walter were able to get the young woman, later identified as Jodie Loomis, to the hospital by 5:45. Despite their efforts to get her help as quickly as possible, Jodie was pronounced dead upon her arrival at the hospital. Jodie had been killed by a .22 caliber gunshot to the right side of her head, just above her right ear. A subsequent medical review of her autopsy file theorized, based on the bullet's path, that Jodie had been on the ground, trying to get her clothes back on after being raped, when her killer had stood over her and shot her. Jodie's bicycle was found in a ravine 180 feet away from where she was found, but the horse bridle she had taken with her that day was never located. Police performed interviews and followed up on leads for years after the murder, but ultimately, the case went cold. In 2008, there was a new push to close the decades-old case. Jodie was featured on the Ten of Hearts card in a deck of cold case playing cards. A set of cards, each featuring a photo and information about an unsolved case from Snohomish County, was created, and 5,000 decks of the cards were printed using funds from a donation from the Stillaguamish tribe. The decks were distributed to inmates in local county jails, as well as in the state prison complex, in hopes that inmates would recognize crimes they had heard other inmates discuss or take credit for, and report what they had heard. Investigators also revisited the physical evidence in the case. Unfortunately, several important items, including the swabs taken at Jody's autopsy and the socks she had been wearing, had been lost over the years, potentially when the evidence was moved from the original room where it was stored into a newer facility. However, some of the evidence they still had would provide them with a lead that would ultimately close the case. The pair of St. Moritz ankle-high waffle stomper boots that Jody had been wearing when she was killed. The boots actually belonged to Jody's sister Jana, and she had borrowed them without asking, as Jana herself had gone horseback riding with a friend on the morning of August 23, 1972. Jody was not even 5 feet tall and had a very slight build, so she could still fit into the size 5.5 boots her 12-year-old sister had just gotten for the new school year. The Snohomish County Sheriff's Office had what physical evidence they still had, including the boots, sent to the Washington State Patrol Crime Lab to be re-examined. During the examination, a scientist noticed a tiny stain on the left boot. It turned out to be a semen stain, and DNA was extracted from the sperm it contained. Further testing was performed on the DNA in 2010 and 2011. The profile was compared to DNA samples provided by potential suspects and men living in the area surrounding the site where Jody was found. It was also run through criminal databases, but no match was found. In May of 2018, another Snohomish County cold case was solved when William Talbot II was arrested and charged with the 1987 murder of 18-year-old Tanya Van Kylenborg. The following month, he was also charged with the murder of her boyfriend, 20-year-old Jay Cook, who had disappeared with Tanya. Talbot was convicted of both murders in June of 2019. He had been identified using genetic genealogy, making Tanya and Jay's case the first in which the technique was used in successfully leading to a suspect being convicted in court. After identifying Talbot and arresting him, Snohomish County authorities began using the same technique in Jody's case, hoping that genetic genealogy would help identify her killer as well. In July of 2018, they sent the DNA profile to Parabond Nanolabs and began working with an Oregon-based genealogist to try to find relatives of the killer in public genealogy databases. After the DNA profile from the crime scene was uploaded into one such database, the genealogist identified individuals she believed to be third cousins of Jody's killer based on the amount of DNA they had in common. Through her research of their family history, she narrowed down her search until she determined that police were most likely looking for the son of a couple who lived in Edmonds, Washington. Unfortunately, that couple had 7 children, and 6 of them were sons. When authorities began investigating those sons, one of them did stand out as a likely suspect based on non-genetic factors. He had been living just 5 miles from where Jody was attacked and had been accused of various sexual crimes at least 5 times since the 1960s, but had never been convicted on charges stemming from them and received no punishment for them more serious than a citation for lewd conduct he had received in 1968. Authorities began investigating this man and surveilling him in hopes of surreptitiously collecting a sample of his DNA. On August 28, 2018, they observed him standing outside of the Tulalip Resort Casino, drinking a cup of coffee. When he threw the cup in the trash, they collected it and had it sent to the lab. The DNA extracted from that cup was a match to the DNA from the semen stain on the boot Jody had been wearing on the day she was killed. On April 10, 2019, 77-year-old Terrence Miller was arrested and charged with first-degree premeditated murder. Miller had married for the first time when he was 18 and his bride was just 14. Their 2-year marriage resulted in 2 daughters. Miller quickly remarried and had another daughter after their divorce. After his second marriage ended in divorce in 1967, he had married for a third time and had 2 more daughters. His third wife filed for divorce in 1974. He married his fourth wife in 1976, and this marriage finally lasted for more than a handful of years. They were still married when Miller was arrested, selling ceramics out of the garage of their home in Edmonds. Miller had previously worked as a heavy machine operator. Authorities could find no connection between Miller and Jody Loomis. Miller's bail was set at $1 million. On June 14, 2019, he was able to post it and was released. He worked with a bail company, which he paid $100,000, which he would never receive back, to secure his release. According to Snohomish County Sheriff's Office Detective Jim Scharf, this was the only time he could remember a defendant charged with first-degree murder being released in his 42-year career. Miller did have to wear an electronic monitoring device and was only allowed to leave his house for specific reasons like grocery shopping and doctor's appointments. Jody's loved ones were still horrified that the community would be put at risk by his release and that he was allowed to be comfortable at home with his wife while awaiting trial, when he had already had 47 years of freedom following the crime. Miller's trial had originally been set for June of 2019, but his attorneys had applied for and been granted a series of continuances so that they would have more time to prepare their case. In September of 2020, they requested that the court move the trial, which was now due to start the following month, until January of 2021, arguing that they had not had sufficient time to prepare for the trial. While Miller had been arrested a year and a half earlier, they claimed that the events of the previous several months had prevented them from properly preparing. As public defenders, they had dozens of clients and had spent much of the previous months working on emergency bail hearings for clients of theirs who needed to be released from custody because they were considered high risk for serious illness should they be exposed to COVID-19. They therefore now only had a month to interview 3 expert witnesses and 15 civilians they had not interviewed between Miller's arrest in April of 2019 and the start of the pandemic, which they argued was an impossible task. Jody's sister Jana, now Jana Smith, addressed the court at the hearing, describing the long wait her family had endured, both for an arrest to be made and for the trial to finally begin. Given the fact that Jody's case had the longest amount of time between the commission of the crime and a trial in Snohomish County history, Snohomish County Superior Court Judge David Kurtz was not inclined to further delay the trial. He told Miller's attorneys to buckle down and get ready. They in turn vowed to have any potential conviction overturned on appeal because they would not be able to hire and interview their own expert witness due to the time constraint. Miller's attorneys filed one more last-minute motion to have the DNA evidence in the case thrown out in October of 2020, but the motion was denied, and the trial began on October 26th. The passage of time did negatively impact the trial. In addition to the evidence that had been lost over the years, several key individuals in the case had passed away. Both of Jody's parents died without knowing who killed their daughter, her father John in 2005, and her mother Rosemary in January of 2019, less than 3 months before Miller was arrested. Walter Morris, one of the people who discovered Jody and rushed her to the hospital, died a few months prior to the trial. He had given a deposition following Miller's arrest, and a video of it was played in the courtroom. His death was a problem for the prosecution because one of the alternative theories Miller's defense team put forth at trial was that Morris had been the killer, as he had been known to own a .22-caliber rifle in 1972, and he had given different reasons for why he had been in the woods that day to authorities in the various statements he had given them. His death meant that he could not be questioned about the discrepancies or explain them in court. Given the fact that he was in a secret relationship with the 18-year-old girl, who was 15 years his junior, who was with him at the time, there are, of course, obvious reasons why he may not have been forthcoming with his reasons for wanting to be alone with her in a remote wooded area. That girl, Kathy Gogol, was 66-year-old Kathy Lennick at the time of the trial and suffering from metastatic breast cancer. Despite her failing health, she managed to appear in court and was able to testify at the trial. At trial, Miller's attorneys questioned the validity of the DNA evidence, claiming that the work done on the boots was sloppy, careless, and unprofessional. They questioned why the FBI had not previously noticed the semen stain when they were asked to examine the boots in the 1970s, and criticized the sheriff's department for losing parts of the evidence log concerning them. Miller's defense attorneys also argued that there was no definitive proof that the sexual contact Jody had on the day of her death was non-consensual, despite the findings of the medical examiner who performed her autopsy. They also suggested that Jody may not have been murdered at all. Instead, she may have been struck by a stray bullet, as the area where she was found was very remote at the time and popular with hunters and target shooters. The prosecution argued that none of the questions raised by the defense or the alternative scenarios they suggested to create reasonable doubt explained how Miller's semen ended up on the boot when there was no connection between Miller and Jody, or Miller and Jody's 12-year-old sister, who had just recently gotten the boots. While the DNA was their strongest piece of evidence, The prosecution also played a phone call between Miller and his wife, recorded while he was still in custody, for the jury. When it's all over and done with, the trial and all that, I'm going to be in prison. This is not a winnable case. That's the thing, Miller told his wife. I don't like to hear that, she replied. I know, Mama, but that's the way it is, he told her. This is not a winnable case. This is a DNA case, and they have an extremely strong case. You're not going to beat it. Miller's attorneys argued that this was not Miller expressing his guilt in the case, just his fear at being wrongly convicted. The jury began their deliberations on Friday, November 6th. After a few hours, Judge Kurtz sent them home for the weekend. Deliberations resumed again first thing the following Monday morning, November 9th. Just before 10 a.m. that same morning, Miller's wife called 911, reporting that her husband had shot himself in the head. While he had been ordered to surrender any firearms he owned as one of the conditions of his release on bail, he had apparently failed to turn over one of them. He did not survive the injury. 3 hours later, the jury reached a verdict in the case. They had not been informed of Miller's death. Miller's attorneys argued against even allowing the jury to read their verdict, claiming that there was no benefit to the public in the court hearing the verdict they had reached. Prosecutors argued that Jody's family still deserved answers. Judge Kurtz agreed with the prosecution, and the verdict was read. The jury had found Miller guilty of first-degree murder. December 17, 2020 would have been the date of Miller's sentencing hearing had he not killed himself. Instead, a hearing was held to determine whether or not his conviction should stand, given the fact that he had died before he could appear in court to hear the verdict. Miller's attorneys argued that the verdict should not stand, but had to concede that the case law they cited in their argument did not exactly line up with the circumstances of the case at hand, a situation which Judge Kurtz described as extraordinary and somewhat unprecedented. Prosecutors argued that the verdict should stand because Miller had not died in an accident or of an illness. Rather, he had taken his own life as a means of avoiding appearing in court. Judge Kurtz ultimately ruled that throwing out the verdict was not the right thing to do. Labels and symbols are important, and how those cases ended does matter, he told the court. Instead of sentencing Miller, as he normally would after a conviction, he instead signed a document affirming that Miller's guilt had been proven beyond a reasonable doubt in court. After the hearing, Janice Smith thanked the investigators, prosecutors, and scientists who worked so hard on her sister's case, and said that she hopes that the conviction in Jody's case will give hope to other families who are still waiting for answers in cold cases. Truth never dies, Jana said. They thought it was going to die. They thought it was so old that we wouldn't be able to follow through with the truth. And this helps.